Psalm number 1.
I love hanging around with those kind of. Did you notice how that passage goes? It goes like this. You know, those that I enjoy being around are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers. But they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night. And those are the people that I like to hang with. Those who don't mock, and those who spend time meditating upon the word of the Lord. How many of you are not mockers? Come on, you must be good hanging around with me. Oh, we are sinners?
Yeah.
Okay, some of us, yeah, we got that sin thing still. We have to still deal with that. How many of us are meditators upon the Word of God? I thought about that last night as I was trying to fall asleep. And of course, I'm having a real good success at that. So I said, I'm just going to meditate upon the Word. And next thing I know, the Word is going wrong. Now, that's falling asleep to the right stuff. There really is. I also love the history, and even more so, the heritage that makes up what we call the Christian church. And that heritage is what has moved people and nations and cultures to be the best that they can possibly be. Our Christian heritage has brought us many of the civilized organizations and institutions that we've just taken for granted or accepted as normal in our culture. I'm talking about things like hospitals and universities and mental health organizations. Those have all grown out of some significant care ministries within the life of the church through hundreds and hundreds of years as the church has sought to care for and educate the common person. Out of the church, through all of these generations of the church, have come things such as justice ministries and the civil rights movement and basic human decency. I love that. The history and the heritage of this particular church goes back more than 125 years. The other day, I was walking around our church building, just reflecting upon its history and its rich heritage in this community. And I came around this part of the church, these beautiful big front steps that many of you just love to come up those steps for worship on Sunday morning. And just around the corner is the cornerstone. And the cornerstone says 1924. That's when this building was built. I kept walking around the building and I came to the education building, and there's a cornerstone down there at the end down by Mahoney Street that says that education building was built in 1958. I have a photograph of this church, a black and white photograph taken right out here, perhaps over here from the back, and somebody took the picture this way, and there are antique cars in front of it. And it was an antique car night in Lansing. Black and white photograph that was taken in 1930. There's a lot of history to this church, isn't there? Yeah. Have you ever thought about how many people and pastors and events have been a part of this church and its heritage throughout the years? Now, let me share with you some personal history or heritage moments that have occurred on this campus. For example, if I come down onto the main floor, I know that even though right now these pews back here are kind of empty, we had a few people with, I do know that at some point in the life of this church, somebody was sitting back here near where Marcus is sitting and came to Jesus Christ. Sitting right there. Now, many over here and many over there also, but people have come to the Lord Jesus Christ in this place. See this aisle right here? I don't know how many brides have walked down this aisle and have turned this corner to meet their groom standing right here. And they've committed themselves to each other and they've covenanted with God to begin their marriage relationship in that connection of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Maybe some of you are the those brides that at some point walked out of the sign. Did you see this altar rail here? Now, we invite you to come forward on a public moment such as this on Sunday mornings, but I will let you know that through the years, and I'm not talking about just 3 or 4 years ago, I'm talking about maybe 30 or 40 years ago, as long as this sanctuary has been here and this altar rail has been here, trust me, there have been people who have come in here for a private moment, and not just on Sunday mornings, but maybe on a Monday or a Wednesday or a Friday, and they just open up the door to Humphrey Street, or they're over here by the elevator, and they quietly walk in here, and they knelt here, seeking guidance from God. And when they got none, they found that guidance. Up here, I love preaching from this pulpit. And I've preached a lot of sermons from this pulpit. But can you imagine since 1924, the sermons that have been preached here? And I can imagine that while there's a preacher preaching here, up in that balcony, which has absolutely nobody in there right now except Lance, because he's the sound man. Nobody's in the balcony, but before we split into two worship services, contemporary and traditional, that place was full. And there was somebody up there in the balcony who was hearing the preacher, whoever he was, years ago. And that person in the balcony said, yes, did you see this choir loft behind me? Didn't the choir sound good to you? They sound good every Sunday morning. Can you imagine how many anthems have been sung in that choir loft? How many Christmas songs and how many Easter musicals have been shared from there? And because of that music, people for years and years and years in the past, as well as you this day, have found your lives touched with courage because of what has happened in that part of life. This church has had a strong relationship and a love for Jesus throughout all of those years. And I've been thrilled to be able to be a part of that for the last 10 years. We are in some ways today sort of starting a new chapter in the life of this church. Last Sunday, I announced to you all that I was going to be retired and a new pastor would be coming to take my place this summer. But before that happens, we have much to do in the next 5 months of ministry. Much to continue in the time and the years to come in the way of ministry. And much of that will find its strength in the heritage of this in his past. For example, earlier this week, I went upstairs. Actually, it could be earlier this week, because today's the first day of the week. So. Last week, sometime, I went upstairs onto the third floor. I just took to run some kind of an errand, and I walked through, and I just kind of glanced at some of those classrooms. And you know, that building, as I said, was built in 1958, and that means that there's been a lot of Sunday school activity on that part of the building. And when I came here 10 years ago, the elementary school department was up there on the third floor. The youth have used it in years past also. And I just got thinking as I was walking down that hallway, you know, I'm sure that there's been at least one, if not dozens and dozens, of children like 7 years old who are sitting on the floor, maybe around the teacher, as the teacher is sharing a story about maybe Jesus or Abraham or Moses. And that little seven-year-old just had a little candle lit in his heart that began his faith journey because of those stories that were told. Now, across the street now is where our children are. Our children are on the second floor, and our youth on the third floor. They've been over there for about 4 years now. And I can just see it in my mind's eye, a seven-year-old over there in the kids' worship time. Or a 17-year-old, as Philip is worshiping and teaching over there, who are saying, this Jesus person is somebody I should probably pay more attention to. You come back across the street from the Wesley Center, and you come into the Mahoney Street, and all the adult classes are now downstairs on the first floor. But up on the second floor, there's been a lot of Mary Martha joined in with the John Wesley class. But there are all these little signs that were never taken off of the doors. The Sunday school class hadn't been there for 20 years, but the plaque was still there. I got thinking, not about a 7-year-old or a 17-year-old, but about a 70-year-old who showed up to Sunday school and maybe somewhat discouraged because of the things that were going on in their life or in their health, and they walked out of there encouraged by the lesson they learned about the Lord. And that happens not just occasionally, but every Sunday morning in the life of this church. Now, I recognize the insight of the original building committee, who probably started to gather and talk about building this building, not in 1924, but maybe in 1921 or 1920. And I know from the history, the reading of the history of this church, that they said, we don't want to just build a little clapboard church on the corner out here. We want to build a church that's going to be a landmark for years to come in downtown Bend City. And that's what this building has done. And that's what this congregation has been. It has been a landmark congregation in Bend City for all of the years. I understand the wisdom of the church back in 1999 when, even without knowing what they would do with it, they decided to build an old, or to buy a white elephant old bank over here. How many of you banked in that before you worshiped over there, or you're going to get a meal over there? Yeah. It's been several different banks. But SunTrust Bank decided that they didn't want to be landlords anymore. And so they put it up for sale, and we bought. And I know that caused a lot of conflict in this church back in 1999 and 2000.
Yeah.
And because, you know, what are we going to do? Tear it down and build a parking lot? They fix up the first floor as a fellowship hall and rent out the other rooms on the second and third floor. Get the asbestos out of there. Some of you who are here, you remember all of that. But now, 15 years later, look at the incredible ministry. Ministries that we didn't know were going to happen, but because we asked the Lord to lead us, He's led us there. Worship and fellowship meals and Christ Community Cafe and Children's Sunday School and Youth Wednesday and Vacation Bible School and something. All coming out of that door. For all of you who have been a part of that type of heritage in the past, I say thank you. Whether you've been here for 50 years or just for the past 5 years, you have been a part of that which has helped to make this church great. And I am so fortunate that I've been able to be a part of that. So where do we go from here? Well, as we look forward into the future, the direction of the next chapter of this church finds itself in the words of Jesus. In Matthew chapter 28, we hear Jesus say, go and make disciples. We call that the Great Commission. That life is best lived when it is guided by a wonderful purpose. I hope you understand that, because I preach that a lot. Life is best lived when it is guided by a beautiful purpose. And Jesus knew that, and that's why he gave us such wonderful teachings as the Great Commandment and the Sermon on the Mount. And that which we're looking at today, the Great Commission. That last one is Jesus' calling to the church to be about helping others discover him as their Savior and Lord. So let's look at that one in a little bit more detail. But first, we remember those words of Jesus where he said, go and make disciples. Now the best thing a church can do is to take unchurched people and help introduce them to Christ. We do a lot of stuff on this campus from week to week. Hundreds of things get done on this campus within a month's time. But there is nothing more important for the ministry of this church than being sure that people are brought to Jesus and introduced to him as Lord. A little while ago, a family stopped me on their way out of church. And they've been worshiping here for maybe 2 or 3 months at the time. And they shared with me their story. They said, you know, we've given up on the church years ago. But then a friend of ours invited us to come to just one worship service here. And we came. And we got interested. Our responsibility is to simply draw people closer to Jesus. Think about someone here in Land City whom you know. Might be a neighbor or a co-worker who is an unbeliever. Or think of somebody, maybe it's even your best friend, who hasn't thought about Jesus for a long time. Drifted away from the church, and they don't wake up on Sunday morning with Jesus on their mind, let alone the day of Saturday. They haven't ever thought about Jesus. Now I want you to visualize what it might be like if you could do some things to help draw them back to Jesus. Or if we, as a congregation, could do some things that would help them draw them back to Jesus. Did you see this altar we're talking here? We need some fresh new needs needed here as they accept Jesus Christ. Because that is the primary role and responsibility of the church. Jesus said, go and make disciples. So we've been about that in the past. Let's continue to be about it in the future. Number two, the Bible goes on to say that Jesus says, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Did you know that there is nothing magical about baptism? There is no hocus pocus and suddenly you have become a Christian. Be ye sprinkled or dunked or dipped, it doesn't matter. Because really, before a person walks forward to receive baptism, they've already accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. They're already a Christian. They've already begun to build their relationship with Jesus. But baptism is a rite of passage that opens the door for someone to become a member of Jesus' family. The door opens and something mysterious, and not magical, but something mysterious happens that draws them closer to Jesus said, baptize, so that the church would intentionally welcome new believers into the faith. And so that's what we're really all about. A number of years ago now, I met a young woman who was standing right down here at the bottom of our big beautiful steps, standing down, smoking a cigarette of all things on Sunday morning. And so I walked up to her, and I could tell that this was one of those nervous cigarette moments. And I introduced myself to her, and she says, I just dropped my child off to the nursery, and I don't know what to do next. It's been a long time since I've been to like a worship service, and I'm not really sure I want to go in there. So I invited her to come, and I walked with her up the steps, and I invited her to come in through those doors. And I showed her some seats. I said, actually, my mom sit in the back for the last half. Halfway through the service again. Fast forward a couple of months, actually almost a year, and we celebrated her baptism and her joining the church. That's what we're supposed to be about. She eventually got assimilated into the life of this church. She joined a small group and became active in the church. What I learned was she was a single mom with one child. She was working full-time. She was trying to go to college part-time. She was divorced. And she had come to church looking for a family. And guess what? She found a family. That's kind of what we're about. Okay, before you leave campus today, I want you to take a look around, both on this north side of Mahoney Street and on the south side of Mahoney Street. For example, we have what I consider to be one of the most beautiful and worshipful traditional sanctuaries anywhere to be found. Just look at the stained glass. Look at the beauty of this woodwork up here and the place. But look at the pews you're sitting on that are the same pews people sat on in 1924. And a lot of people have been worshiping.
And we intentionally offered traditional worship here because people needed, and people would be drawn to this church.
Take a look across the street at that old bank building, which is now a beautiful new Wesley Center, to that incredible worship service location, that contemporary service.
It's like we've got the best of both worlds on this campus. And there is so much that goes on and gets done on this campus because we have both the north side and the south side of the world. Any day, someone can walk on this campus because they're in need of a family. They may not even know they're in need of a family, but they come walking onto this campus because they need something. And they find Jesus' family. And that's really what we're all about. That's why we're here. Number three. Matthew 28 continues with these words from Jesus. Jesus said, teach them everything that I have taught you. I'd like you to do something right now. I want you to think of something that you have learned about God because you've been a part of a church. And think about something that you've learned about Christ because you've been a part of this church. Without the organization we call the church, we wouldn't have the kind of knowledge that we have. Somebody at some time in your life taught you, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells us. Right? Yeah. At some point in your life, sometime along the way, maybe it was through a hymn, or maybe it was through a sermon, but you learned a bunch of stuff about Amazing Grace. Maybe it was from a Sunday school teacher or a preacher or maybe even one of your friends. But somehow along the way, in the midst of you being a part of a church, you learned about forgiveness. And you learned that that forgiveness comes through our Savior, Jesus. I'm sure you have heard the scripture, and I hope that you have embraced it, the scripture that says, when you become a believer, the old person within you begins to die and a new creation springs up. The old person is that old sinful person. It begins to die. And what springs forth in you is that new creature that Jesus Christ wants to form and create within you. Maybe you've learned that right here in this very room. I hope that you have. There are hundreds of other people living in Tennessee that need to hear those messages. There are hundreds of people in Tennessee that don't think about church, let alone think about Jesus Christ. What might we do together to help that happen? In the months and yes, even in the years to come, what might you do to help that happen? Can you think in your mind's eye of just how Jesus might be ready to use you in some kind of special way to do that? I want you to look around and see if you can find an empty seat in this place. I'm serious. Look around. I'm not going to continue with the sermon until I see that you all look around. I want you to look around. Do you see some empty seats? Look up there. Lance is the only one sitting up there. I want you to visualize in your mind's eye somebody sitting in that seat.
Soon.
I want you to do more than just pray. I want you to pray for people to fill the pews in this place because something of the ministries that we have done here have drawn them closer to Jesus. And they're sitting there maybe for the first time in worship. Maybe for the first time, sending this to Jesus. That's your homework assignment. Go home and pray that we fill these seats. right now,